is legitimately practiced or not. So in general, I've been working now for 4 years in the field. And I've also been associated with the Nation Association Body in Netherlands. I'm a delegate of the Dutch committee who works on issues of nanotechnology standards.
Okay. Presentation is the first slide.
Excuse me?
The title of your presentation is your first slide. It's in the screen.
Yes, okay, great. So I can start now, right?
Yes.
Okay, so today I'm going to an overview of what I've been working in this research during my PhD. So for this presentation, I'm going to talk first about the legitimacy of this arrangement. In particular, I will focus on the role of international standards in the field of nanotechnology. And then I will talk about the framework that I've developed to measure the legitimacy of this arrangement. And lastly, about the perceptions of stakeholders with regards to this organization. So would you mind if you go on the next slide?
Okay.
Yeah. So if you can see in this slide, at the presentation overview, I would firstly talk about the framework that I have developed to measure the legitimacy of these arrangements, which I have framed as TBGAs, which refers to transnational private governance arrangements. Then I will talk about the key legitimacy norms and indicators that I have identified to measure the legitimacy of this arrangement. And thirdly, I will focus on the perceptions of respondents. Basically, in the case of ISO, I've done 76 surveys with different stakeholders that have been involved in the work of TC229. TC229 is a technical committee that is set within the ISO to work on issues related to nanotechnology.
Okay. And the
now we can go on slide, the next slide, please.
Okay.
Yeah. So to begin with regard to the legitimacy in this research, I frame legitimacy as a relational concept between a transnational institute and one actor or stakeholder. Basically, my focus is to see how legitimacy or how legitimate a particular governance arrangement is perceived in practice by relevant stakeholders. And before I go in details about legitimacy, just to give you a hint why legitimacy matters at this point, is that in comparison to other traditional arrangements which develop within the scope of the nation state, these transnational governance arrangements, they develop beyond the state level and they involve a wide range of actors coming from around the world. So actually, these arrangements are setting various transnational norms, which even though are voluntary, they actually can be de facto binding in the sense that, for instance, we are having several technical standards which are becoming very important for a market entry for a particular industry or in a particular sector. And as such, the outcomes set by these arrangements become very important. And then the issue of legitimacy comes forward, because if a particular rule that is set by this governance arrangement beyond the state level are becoming binding, de facto binding, and are not set by state actors, then the question is whether we can trust the rules that are set by these arrangements as legitimate or not. So basically, this is the core idea that drove the whole research that I have been doing with regards to ISO and the role in nanotechnology. So to go back now on the issue of legitimacy, with the term of legitimacy, actually I aim here to describe the fact that a certain group of people, or in my case stakeholders, would accept a particular arrangement or the rules that are set by ISO on the grounds that they first would believe that the norms that guide the functioning of this arrangement are effectively taken up in practice and perceive the outcomes that are set by this organization to provide an effective solution and benefit to the needs of the respondents. So as you can see in the slide, in this research, I view legitimacy as an element or that is defined actually or determined by the perceptions of stakeholders. And would you please go on the next slide?
Okay, but I would like to know about the stakeholders' perception. What kind of stakeholders is in this is in yours say in your yes
yeah yeah that's a very nice question actually. When it comes to the stakeholders, what I have been doing for this research is first we have analyzed the institutional structure and the functioning of the ISO. And within the ISO, then is set this technical committee that works in the field of on issues related to nanotechnology, which is called the TC229. So what I did is I analyzed the meetings organized by this committee, where you can view the main stakeholders that are involved. And in the TC229, there are involved a wide range of stakeholders coming from industry, coming from governmental and regulatory agencies, from consumer organizations, from NGOs. Also, stakeholders, other stakeholders representing the interests of trade unions. So, in order to find out and the perceptions of these multiple stakeholders, what I did surveys not with one type of stakeholders, but I did surveys with actors coming from industry, with actors coming from all of these governmental and regulatory agencies, civil society organizations, and so forth. So, basically, the surveys were done with these stakeholders. Based on the number of actors that I could identify after analyzing the meetings that were held by this committee.
Trade unions, it's NGOs, it's consumers.
Yes?
Yes, okay. But this, about the quantities, each trade unions about the consumers and NGOs. You can talk for us something about quantities of this kind of the stakeholders?
The questions you mean that I did to them?
No, if you can talk for us about quantity in relationship of trade union of consumers and in relationship of NGOs.
You mean the role that these organizations are having within the committee?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I can go now, but as you will see later in the presentation, I touch on that much more when I talk about the extent to which they are involved in the committee, which I found very interesting because these organizations, the structure of the TC229 works in the way that the participation of this of every actor in TC229 is voluntary. So basically, they have to finance their participation by themselves. And as such, for NGOs, trade unions, it is an act, this lack of sufficient financial resources, it seems to be a bit of a barrier for them to follow all of the meetings that TC229 is having, and also to have as much contribution as these groups would want to have. Because, of course, if you are not able to attend all the meetings, then of course your role and impact in this in the standards that are set by this committee would be a bit lower. And the, also another element is that most of these organizations are having an observatory status in the committee, which means that these actors actually can participate in these meetings, but most of the time they are serving as observers, which means that they are not voting on the final standardization outcomes. But as I will reflect later on, DC-229 seems to have acknowledged this the importance of consumer and in general civil society organizations by setting two task groups which work on the consumer and societal dimensions and on sustainability issues.
Okay, you can continue.
Okay, great. So maybe we can move at slide number 5, please. In this slide, you can see that I've developed an evaluative matrix. An evaluative matrix for measuring the legitimacy of these transnational private governance arrangements related to technology regulation, in particular in this case for measuring the legitimacy of ISO related to nanotechnology. So my starting point before I did the survey was just to solve the question how we are going to measure legitimacy. If we talk about legitimacy, what do we need to know? How we are going to measure it? So what I did, I set several norms, as you can see in the slides, and they were meaningful participation, deliberative decision-making, effective process control, trustworthy expertise, and implementable outcomes. So what these are telling is that I have been trying to measure here to what extent stakeholders perceive the process to be inclusive, to offer them appropriate opportunities to get included in the process, to influence decisions set by this committee, and in the element of deliberative decision making, I did questions with regards to what extent, for instance, the interests of several parties were taken into account, whether they were able to communicate with other members in the committee to find an agreement about certain decisions and so forth. With regards to effective process control, I looked to what extent the committee in nanotechnology was considered to be transparent and accountable. Fourth, I looked at the element of expertise, where my interest was to see whether stakeholders actually perceived the process to be based on highly qualified experts, on robust and scientifically valid evidence, as well as on objective judgments. And the last element was the implementable outcomes, where I was interested to see on how these standards that were set by DC-229 were taken up in practice. So as after mentioning these norms, what I did, I set certain performance indicators, which actually serve as an element to measure these norms, for instance, inclusiveness, representation, and resources. So this was the basis that guided actually the way how I did the survey then. So I set a value from 1 to 5 to each question, and then the respondents were evaluating, for instance, to what extent they would think that the process is inclusive to them. From 1 to 4 to 5, they would evaluate the process. And then the cumulative value of all of these indicators would indicate the extent to which they perceived, in general, the DC-229 to be legitimate.
Okay.
Yes. So is it clear so far?
Yeah.
Where is the case study? Yeah. So in this case study, as I've been mentioning continuously throughout this presentation, I looked at the International Organization for Standardization. Actually, what ISO did in 2004 is that they created a technical committee to work on nanotechnology issues. The main objective of this committee was to provide industry, research, and regulators with robust and well-funded standards in the field of nanotechnologies, basically to help them to create a smooth transition from the laboratory to the marketplace. As we will see later on, also on the business plan of the PC229, it is mentioned that the key objectives of this committee are to actually facilitate global trade, to reduce scientific uncertainties that exist in the field of nanotechnology, and also to provide solutions for the regulatory uncertainties, or to support the regulation of nanotechnology. So to achieve all of these objectives, TC229 set four working groups. These working groups are working on four issues, as you can see in the slide, basically on terminology and nomenclature, in setting standards for measurement and characterization, health, safety and environment, and material specifications. So all of these groups involve actually a wide range of actors that are coming from the national standardization bodies. They go at the ISO to work on these issues. Because the process works as such that the national standardization bodies in each country, they would send delegates at the international level where they can discuss about the technical standards that are going to be set at the international level.
Information about the consumer and the social dimensions of nanotechnology.
Yeah, these actually are two task groups that were set in TC229. The main idea, as I mentioned before, was that TC229 started initially with the four working groups. But as we know, in the field of nanotechnology, there are many issues that also concern consumers and have a broader impact rather than the technical impact that these standards involve. So to address the broader societal concerns related to nanotechnology and to encourage that an input is received from relevant consumer, societal and other relevant organizations, TC229 set two task groups that are working on sustainability and consumer and societal dimensions. And I've been in one of these meetings before 2 years. It was in Stresa in Italy. And actually, these task groups were quite active. And the number of of representatives in these task groups was quite representative, in the sense that they were discussing issues that matter to the to consumers and the broader society in general. And last year, actually, there was done a survey with national standardization bodies by one of these TGs, where they actually were interested to know how different actors are involved in the national standardization bodies and what were the main barriers for different actors and for different member countries, actually, to participate in the TC229. So basically here the main idea was to identify what were the main problems for different actors to participate in this committee, to participate in setting technical standards, and also to, of course, to provide an overview to the TC229 on what would be the next steps that would be received.
Okay.
Yes.
We can go to the next.
I just wanted to mention one element here with regards to the member states. Currently, TC229 has 35 participatory members and 10 observatory members. I wanted to mention this for one reason, because besides the functioning that I mentioned, how ISO functions with regards to national standardization bodies, and then the ISO, it is important to know that in the TC229, when we talk about participatory members, they actually have the right not only to participate in the meetings, but also to vote on the standardization proposals, whereas observatory members, they mostly serve as observers. And for the legitimacy, it matters also another element, which I've mentioned in the slide, which is the agreement that the World Trade Organization, ISO, has with the World Trade Organization. In particular, TC229 has assigned itself to this to the WTO principles, which means that under this agreement, ISO must implement the principles of good governance. meaning that it needs to take into account the issue of consensus, transparency, accountability, and representation. So this is very important because ISO actually acknowledges that for the process and the way how actors involved and how the decisions are set, it matters for the final outcome.
Okay.
Yeah. Now we can go to the next slide. Are there any questions so far?
I did my question in the moment when you are talking about the last slide.
Yeah.
So we can go to the meaningful participation.
Okay, great. So what I will do in the following, I will talk about those norms that I mentioned earlier. I think it was in slide number 5. Where I mentioned the 5 norms of meaningful participation, deliberative decision making, effective process control, trustworthy expertise, and implementable outcomes. So now what I will do is I will talk about each of these norms and guide you through the perceptions of the respondents on each of these norms. Actually, I asked them about the process, the expertise, how transparent was the process, whether they were complying with the outcomes that TC229 was setting, and so forth. So with regards to the meaningful participation, my interest was to see to what extent these stakeholders that I surveyed, they perceived the process to be inclusive, to what extent they felt that they could participate in the process, and also to what extent they felt that their interests were taken into account. What I saw here was that respondents from both developed and less developed countries, they seemed to be relatively satisfied with the opportunities that they have had to participate at the national standardization bodies and also at the TC229. However, as I mentioned also earlier, resources were amongst the major barriers for all respondents. Because in the process, the participation of these respondents is funded by the respondents themselves. So, and these meetings, the TC229 meetings, are done in different countries, various countries of the world. So actually, it takes their no. time to participate in these meetings, and their participation has to be funded by the participants themselves, which for some stakeholders seemed to be a real barrier in order for them to follow all the meetings and have an effective contribute in the process in general. What I also saw is that other barriers also related to the lack of time, and some respondents also indicated that were not aware as much as they would want to about the issues. Standardization issues with regards to the field of nanotechnology. When it comes to the different actors, I saw that respondents from industry, research institutes, and governmental agencies, they appear generally to be more satisfied than NGOs and trade unions with the level of participation that they have had at the national standardization bodies, but also at the TC229.
Okay, but what do you think is the reason that the actors from industry
Yeah, the main reason actually were the lack of financial resources, because what I saw in the survey was that the issue of resources was continuously mentioned by these actors. Financially, industry and research institutes, but also governmental agencies, seemed to be generally more able to support their participation in these meetings, whereas for NGOs and trade unions was a bit more of a problem. Because, as I said, these meetings are held in various countries of the world, and sometimes these meetings are done via online mechanisms or tools, but also there are many face-to-face meetings. For instance, at the TC229, you have the biannual meetings, which now are held every 10th month of the year in different countries of the world. And so it is a bit difficult for these actors to support continuously their participation in these meetings. Also, slightly, I could see also that there was also a bit the issue of expertise. Basically, the extent to which they thought that they have the appropriate resources, if I may say so, to have an effective contribute in all of the issues related to nanotechnology standardization. So these were the main issues that I could observe.
Okay, can continue.
Yes, and also I can mention again that this pay-to-play requirement, like you have to fund your participation, in general has become it is a problem for actors coming from these smaller organizations. If you go at the slide number 8.
No, but please, I have another question in this slide. You put requirements at the TC229 has led to the under representation of actors can from smaller organization. I think I would like to listen something about this for you.
With this, the last element, the pay-to-play requirement, actually I here want to refer to what I just mentioned before, because given that in TC229 the participation is voluntary and has to be funded by actors themselves, it is a bit more difficult for smaller organizations to participate in the same. By smaller organizations, I mean those organizations that are involving less employees, but also that are having less financial means to participate continuously. To support the participation of their delegates at the national standardization bodies, but also at the TC229. So the fact that this participation is voluntary and there are no financial means provided, it becomes a bit difficult for a set of organizations to participate in these meetings in an effective way. Because, you know, if you look also at the national standardization bodies, national standardization bodies also finance themselves through membership fees. For instance, that means that you as a delegate from a particular industry, you participate at the national standardization bodies, but your time in these bodies is not paid by a particular standardization bodies, neither it is paid your participation. Now, there are some exceptions, because some national standardization bodies, they also provide some funds for some actors, but that is not the case in each body. So the structure of the national standardization body is different from one country to the other one. And for what I saw is that some respondents which were associated with those national standardization bodies, which actually were funding themselves through membership fees, they were concerned that the fact that they were not able to participate in a very active way in these meetings, that this actually could lead to the participation gap of these under-resourced groups. By under-resourced groups, I mean those that do not have sufficient financial resources.
So, pay-to-play requirements. Medium term, if you are a big company or so it's important, because if you are from middle or smaller company, nanotechnology company, and bigger company, you have different conditions to participate of the TC 229.
Yeah, that's a fact. Yeah. And I have also to say that in the ISO in general, also there are taken several initiatives. For instance, there are developed some committee for supporting the participation of less developed countries of consumer organizations. But when I asked the respondents about these activities, they were generally relatively satisfied. And they also were saying that there are much more efforts need to be taken, both by the national standardization bodies in terms of thinking of a better strategy of supporting financially, or you know, having much more financial means for these actors in order for them to be much more involved in this in the activities of these standardization bodies.
Okay, we can.
So yeah, in the next slide, I just wanted to give an overview of how the scores rate in terms of what the respondents were saying. So if you look at the issue of inclusiveness representation, it falls much higher. So the respondents are much more satisfied with their inclusiveness and representation and the TC229, but they're less satisfied with the level of resources.
Okay.
Yeah, so on the next slide.
Okay.
Yeah, I would talk about the next norm, which was deliberative decision making. Besides the meaningful participation, in this study I've also looked at the extent to which actors were able to contribute and influence the content of the ISO standards in the decision-making process. And also I was interested to see how effective actually was the interaction amongst participants, as well as the setting of disputes when there were conflicts amongst different participants on setting or taking a decision, for instance, on a technical standard. And what I could see from the survey is that yes.
Okay.
Yeah, that the respondents from less developed countries, as well as those associated with NGOs, trade unions, academia, and regulatory agencies, they were less likely than developed countries and those that were associated with industry research institutes and governmental laboratories to view TC229 decision-making process as deliberative. And the main reason for this was that often less developed countries, they are represented by smaller delegations and they have fewer resources, which also seems to have impacted the possibilities for these actors to influence the content of the standards and also create closer relationship with delegates from other countries. And now this matters because in the TC229 there is not a rule that would say how many delegates you can send from the national level at the international level. And because of the lack of resources, some respondents emphasize that they end up participating on ad hoc basis. And therefore, they felt that this creates a bit of difficulty is also to create closer relationship with delegates that were coming from other countries. Also, mention was made here to the fact that some of them argued that in the nanotechnology standardization process, the power politics and negotiation tactics were also very important. They played an important role on how powerful actors, such as those coming from developed countries, industries, and research institutes, also gained important positions in the working groups, such as chairing the meetings or being conveners and so forth, and also push proposals on issues that they were interested. What we see in the TC229 is that the institutional structure, as I mentioned before, the ISO actually grants access and voting rights mostly to those who pay the membership fees, which also may serve as another explanation on why some respondents feel a bit less included in the process against the others.
Okay.
Yeah, and on the last element, I also was interested on the issue of consensus decision making, because one of the main elements as part of the agreement with the World Trade Organization is that the consensus is one of the main principles guiding the development of the international standards. Some of the barriers that were mentioned here were that some respondents said that the language barriers for some respondents were a bit of a difficulty. Also, some of them mentioned that the lack of sufficient knowledge and also the various background of experts in the working groups in some cases was a particular problem to achieve a consensus on the decisions about the technical standard.
Okay.
Yeah, so if you go on
the next,
is it clear so far?
Yeah, you can go the next.
So yeah, so on the next slide, just an overview, we can see that actually the lowest score on the effective dispute settlement, basically respondents felt that there were, as compared to other performance indicators, the reaching an agreement amongst the respondents seems to be much more of a difficulty in the committee. Yeah, now if you want, we can go with the next slide.
Okay.
Yeah, so here I focused on the effective process control. As I mentioned earlier, my interest was to see to what extent respondents felt that they were able to access the process and whether there were appropriate mechanisms of transparency and accountability embedded within the committee. What I was able to see with regards also to the structure is that participants at TC229, they are mostly registered and identified by their country of origin. And at the national standardization bodies, they participate voluntarily without having any pre-selection procedure most often. So their participation actually depends on the interest that they have on a relevant issue that is going to be standardized. But the fact that these actors are actually identified by their country of origin, also at the international level, it makes it difficult, for instance, to determine who is going to be held accountable for the decision that was made at the international committee. So it creates a level of difficulty to determine how you can hold, for instance, a particular participant directly accountable for their decisions. The structure of the TC229 in general indicates that the committee is open to members who are paying for their membership fees. And at this point, those participants that were less involved in the process, they indicated that they found the process to be less transparent because they were less able to access the documents of the committee. But also to have a detailed access on, for instance, on the discussions that were held in the meetings or who made a particular decision, how a particular decision was made. So these elements were mentioned to be difficult for some actors to know what is going on in the process. And furthermore, as I mentioned before, the fact that some respondents, usually mostly coming from less developed countries, they were following these meetings on ad hoc basis, then they indicated that it was a bit difficult for them to know what happened continuously in those meetings and how the decisions were made, mainly because then they also did not have detailed access on the documents to know how the decisions were made. So in this regard, the issue of transparency and accountability was considered to be lower than other respondents.
Nice one.
Yes. So.
Okay.
Yeah, and I also want to mention here the fact that with regards to consumer and societal groups, as I mentioned before, they were set these two task groups on sustainability and consumer and societal dimension on our technology. And also respondents viewed that these initiatives were very important and needed to be applauded, in fact, Because in a way their main initiative of them was to actually involve much more these civil society organizations to get included in the process and to know much more what is going on in the process to make the actions of this organization more accountable to the broader range of stakeholders. However, still some of them were a bit more concerned because they still were questioning the actual impact of these task groups in practice. Yes. So, if you go in the next slide.
The next is the number.
It's number 12.
12. Okay.
Yeah, so in the number 12, you will see an overview of all performance indicators, and where you can see that actually the external accountability or the extent to which TC229 was considered to be accountable to actors that were not directly involved in the committee was considered to be lower than other performance indicators.
Mm-hmm. Very good.
And yeah, now we can put the trust. Expertise?
13?
Fine.
It's 13? Yeah.
It's slot 13, yeah.
Okay.
So then I looked at the, after looking at the process, then I was interested to see about the role of the expertise and expert knowledge at TC229. Because expertise is one of the most crucial elements considered in the literature to guide the functioning and the importance of these transnational private governance arrangements, because they are considered to be built on the decisions that are made by experts who actually know the field and have the practical experience in a particular sector. So even though the issue of expertise is not included formally into the normative requirements of the TC229, however, the need for expertise is emphasized in several standards. For instance, if you look at the standards related to health and occupational safety, there is often indicated that practitioners, scientists, and those that are working on issues or of toxicology is very important. And generally, in the surveys, what I could observe is that respondents highly appreciated the role of the expert and expertise and expert knowledge at the TC229. In their view, the development of nanotechnology standards relied on the expert knowledge that was founded by private companies, research institutes, and governmental and civil society organizations. So most of the respondents actually indicated that they perceived the TC229 standards result from highly qualified experts in the field of nanotechnology. However, in some working groups, some of them indicated that there was observed a domination of the respondents coming from industry, research institutes, and governmental agencies. And looking at the background of these actors, they had mostly a background in chemistry, material science, and in physics. So when we looked at the responses of the surveys, the responses seems to suggest that an explanation for the domination of these actors again could be the powerful resource that they have in general to afford their active participation in the committee, also to create powerful networks and to mobilize the scientific data to contribute to nanotechnology standardization. And the fact that there was observed in some working groups some issues, the domination of some actors in the process seemed also to raise questions and doubt about the extent to which these experts were independent in their decisions and judgments at the TC229. So in general, in the committee, the independence of experts was perceived in general to be not so high. Some respondents actually indicated that in some working groups there was a tendency to support some proposals that were based on the country or on the employer's priorities rather than on technical merits. And besides objectivity, your number of surveys also appear to be concerned with the scientific basis of nanotechnology standards. In TC 2009, the need for standards to be based on scientifically valid and robust results have been acknowledged in various documents and reports. However, in some cases, we can also observe the fact that since nanotechnology is an emerging technology, and there are in some cases there is a lack of sufficient scientific knowledge and certainty on relevant nanotechnology issues. These issues were considered to be also among the main challenges, which, as the respondents argue, also raise many questions about the validity and the robustness of the results guiding the development of nanotechnology standards. With issues of robustness, just for clarification, I was interested here to see the extent to which, for instance, a decision is based in such a result that remains unchanged for a long period of time. But the respondents argued that this is difficult for the issue of nanotechnology standards because the field as such is emerging and is evolving continuously. So there is there are some difficulties in some cases to predict the long term.
I would like to discuss this slide with you. And the beginning from the first, expertise and expert knowledge at TC 229, I highly appreciate by the surveys. Okay.
Yes.
What is the reason that you find in the surveys that is the expertise and expert knowledge at TC 229? I highly appreciate. What is the reason?
Yeah, I was here interested much more to see to what extent, like the question that I made was, I asked the respondents to score, for instance, the extent to which they felt that the decisions in TC 229 were based on a highly qualified expert, so basically on those experts who are having an experience with TC 229 nanotechnology standardization, who have been involved for a long period of time on issues related to nanotechnology, but also on issues related to standardization. So there were interrelated questions. First, I asked them to evaluate, to indicate their own level of expertise, ranging from basic to expert knowledge. And also, I asked them to evaluate what were their feeling or their perception with regards to the expertise of their peers or the expertise of other delegates in these meetings. And in both cases, I saw that expertise was evaluated or appreciated or perceived to be very high in the technical committee.
Okay.
If you would please, on the next, in the slide 14. Yeah, you can see here that the competent expertise, actually, this indicator received the highest score. And I also can say that this was one of the indicators that received the highest score, not only from the performance indicators within the norm of trustworthy expertise, but also from all other indicators that explained other legitimacy norms.
Okay.
Yes.
I would like to come back the previous slide. And this conception that the development of nanotechnology standards relies on expert knowledge, that I agree with you, founded mainly in private companies, that I agree, research institute, that also I agree, government and the regulatory agents, that I agree, And you finish putting as well as civil society organization. I do not agree. And for this, I would like to see what is your reasons. What is this civil
yes? Well, it would be great if I also could, why you would not agree? What do you mean by this?
Yeah, exactly, because first of all, I would like to know what are the civil society organizations.
Yeah, well, in general, because it's a slight presentation, so to save being too wordy, I put them as civil society organizations because in my concept, civil society organizations encompass NGOs, trade unions, so these are consumer organizations in general. So that's what I mean by civil society organizations. And I don't know how clear is this sentence, but basically what I have been able to see is that you can actually find experts that contribute to the field of nanotechnology or who are working in the field of nanotechnology and are associated with private companies, research institutes, governmental and regulatory agencies, and also organizations that civil society organizations, and that includes organizations that I just mentioned, like there are many NGOs, there are many consumer organizations that are having experts and are willing and are working to contribute on issues related to nanotechnology, including here issues of nanotechnology standards or standardization. So that's what I meant by this.
I think it is this, because what is the trade the consumers could contribute for the standardization or to make something about standards in nanotechnology?
Well, I mean, when I participated in the meeting in Stresa in TC29, you could see that, of course, civil society organizations are very important, especially when it comes to the issue of labeling. For instance, the issue of labeling consumer products that involve organizations, and these issues were originally at the European level, basically at the committee working at CEN committee working on European standards, but then TC29 took over this issue. So that meant that if you are labeling consumer products, if you are labeling products that are involving consumer products that are involving nanomaterials, of course, that matters for the consumers because they have to be informed about the products that they are buying or they are using and what kind of materials are involved in such products and what kind of impact that product will have for consumers. And one thing and the other thing is whether we are informing in the right way consumers about the product with regards to the nanomaterials that the product involves. Given that there are so many discussions on what do we mean by nano and what is the scale of these materials. So you could see that in these TGs, task groups, there was a very high interest of these organizations, and they were relatively involved, if I may say, on issues of nanotechnology standards. Also in the working group 3, which work on health and safety standards, which is beyond labeling a consumer product, you can also, I could also observe that these organizations were quite interested on such issues, because those issues are broader than, for instance, setting only a standard, for instance, for defining nanotechnology, which is working group 1, which works on terminology and nomenclature, but these also are setting standards for health and safety issues, or standards, for instance, for how you are going to label a particular product.
propose for you.
Excuse me?
I have one propose for you.
Yes.
Okay? Because our program is in the finishing.
Okay, great. Well, I'm also by the end, so I can hear your proposal.
Yeah. My proposal for you is this. Because we are in the finish, we can continue your presentation to finish the slides that you put for your presentation in another program.
Yeah, actually there are, I would be, I mean, I will leave it up to you. There are only 3 slides left, so we can either wrap it up or continue it in another program with 15 minutes. I don't know. I mean,
I think we can continue in another program. Some suggestion of date for another program.
Okay.
Okay. So we can discuss this beginning, starting of the another problem about in this slide, the 13. We can discuss more in details.
Yeah, that's okay with me.
That's okay for you?
Yes.
Yes. Okay. So. I will send for you some dates, and you you choose the dates that, and we can do another problem with this beginning with this slide, the 13th, and the order that you put, and we can discuss more in detail this kind of conclusion that you put in this slides. Okay?
Yeah, that's fine with me.
Okay. So thank you so much for your contribution for this program, and we will have one second contribution of you, and I will send suggestion for the new dates.
Great, it's my pleasure to be here and to introduce you closer to my research.
Okay, thank you so much.